If you have either an idea or a technology at the right stage, and in this class, you're able to actually go out and talk to customers, talk to people in that industry, vet the concept, and really get some feedback around, you know, the potential pathway to market.
I'm Jason Jacobs, and I am typically the host of the My Climate Journey podcast, but have the honor of guest hosting the Energy Initiative podcast today.
Hi, I'm Todd Hines. I'm the founder and chief strategy officer at XL Fleet, and I'm also a senior lecturer at MIT, where I teach energy ventures.
Well, I'm so excited for this episode, Todd. It's funny. It's been about a year and a half that I've been on this kind of climate journey, coming in from the outside and just learning as much as I can about everything that it's going to take to facilitate this global energy transition. And I met you pretty early on in that journey, and we've now spoken many times. I feel like you're a friend, but I don't know that I've ever taken a good chunk of time like this and done a deep dive into your background and the different things that you do. So I'm so excited for the opportunity.
Yeah, it's great to have this conversation officially. And it's always been good over the last year and a half to connect with you. I think you're doing an amazing job bringing together a great community and helping multiple people that have been in this industry for a long time, as well as newcomers, to have a bigger impact and make some progress.
And then the other thing I should say selfishly is that it's not just a chance to get to know you and your background, but also, I mean, I'm a local boy. I grew up in Newton. I live in Brookline now, and Boston's my home, and MIT is such a world-class institution, and I know that it's doing a number of things to really lead the way as it relates to the clean energy world. But exactly what those things are and all the different initiatives and both the things you've been involved in and otherwise, I stand to have a lot to learn there as well. So I'm psyched to learn more about both of those things. Maybe for starters, just give us an overview of the different things that you've got your hands in MIT-wise and otherwise as it relates to clean energy and climate change.
I've been teaching MIT Energy Ventures since 2008. The class was originally started by Bill Ouellette, who leads the MIT Martin Trust Center for Entrepreneurship. He and I actually co-founded the MIT Clean Energy Prize in the end of 2007, 2008 timeframe. And then he had started the class originally in 2007. So I've been working closely with Bill to help initially launch and then advise the MIT Clean Energy Prize since the 2008 timeframe. And then with Energy Ventures, really worked closely with Bill to get the class going in the first few years. And then Frank O'Sullivan, who used to be with the MIT Energy Initiative, started co-lecturing the course with me. And so he's been with us for a number of years now. And most recently, we added a guest lecturer, Libby Wayman, who works with the Breakthrough Energy Ventures group. And she's a great new addition to the course. So I'll give a quick background on the class. MIT Energy Ventures is a project-based course that brings together engineering, science, business, and policy students from across MIT, as well as some from Harvard, to identify new opportunities in energy and even more so in climate. We've had a number of teams in the last few years that have gone outside of the energy sphere into kind of a more broader climate venture opportunity. And we provide, you know, maybe 15 to 20 different technologies or ideas around the beginning of the class for the students to come in and learn about. And in many cases, students bring their own technologies or ideas. And the whole goal of the class is really to create a kind of a learning by doing, you know, a mens a manis type experience, mind in hand. And it gives the students direct access to various labs or technologies that have been worked on for many years, or it could be a brand new idea that someone has that's a clean sheet of paper. And so those students then form teams of about five students. So you get about seven teams per class. And then they pursue that concept or technology over the course of the semester and really try to create a business plan, a business model, and a company around that concept. So the goal of the class isn't to necessarily start a new company, but it's to really get almost like a first take at the process. And so ideally, by the end of this class, they've actually learned a lot in a compressed time frame of, you know, about 3 months. where they can then go on after the class into the MIT Clean Energy Prize or many of the other competitions in a much better position, having had a lot of insight from a range of industry experts, as well as advisors and mentors we connect to. And so by the time they graduate, they ideally can then go off and start their business or apply what they've learned in that class to the companies that they go in and work for.
So are these undergrad or grad students?
It's a graduate course. We do have typically a few undergrads per year, and they're usually quite strong. We do try to find people that are in the last year of their program. So if it's an MBA, it's a second year MBA. If someone's getting a PhD or a master's, usually it's the last year of whatever program they're in, with that idea being that if the project they have has legs, that they can continue to run with it when they graduate.
And how do you think about the pairings when it relates to team formation? Isn't it entirely up to the students to decide? And what types of skill sets or backgrounds are ideal as it relates to team makeup?
We definitely try and have the team process be organic. We do have an application process for the class, and so we try to get a good mix of students with a range of capabilities and backgrounds. And then each team, we try to have a mix of engineering or technical capabilities, as well as business and policy. And over the years, I'd say the experience of the students coming into the class has increased significantly. When we started the course, maybe 30% had worked in energy. Now it's about 90% of the class has already had a job in energy. 50% have already worked at a startup, and even 10 or 20% have started their own companies. And so we enable the teams and students to really spend the first couple weeks of the course networking with each other, learning about the different projects or potential ideas, and then we give them kind of a format to aggregate around the ones that they're most interested in. And if you can get five students to agree upon one idea, then that's typically a project that gets selected and moved forward. At the end of the day, the instructors and the TA have final say on the teams, but it is very much driven by the students and their interests.
And when I think about clean energy and building companies in clean energy, I mean, it seems like it's a long slog. And when I think about 3 months in the context of a long slog, it seems like not even a blip on the radar. So what type of progress is realistic for these teams to make from a dead start to 3 months in? Like, what's a success look like?
That's very true. You know, it takes a long time to make progress in this world, especially if you have a hardware heavy solution or a science heavy solution. Many of the teams are working off of technologies that have been, you know, in a lab for many years. So you do have, in some cases, millions of dollars that have gone into research for a certain technology. And what they really want to do is figure out, well, all right, what is the best path to market for this technology? And that's where I think we have some great examples of teams that have found a technology that's at the right readiness level for this class. It's not, you know, very early stage, and it's also not too late stage. Obviously, if it's already in the market, it's not a good fit for this course. But and then that gives the teams, you know, a reasonable amount of time to assess a number of different end use applications, specific markets. Where does the right value fit for that technology, and then what's the business plan and the strategy to launch that product? And so a success would be someone that has, and there's also good examples of ideas that students had that were just, you know, the right time in terms of the market. So if you have either an idea or a technology at the right stage, and in this class, you're able to actually go out and talk to customers, talk to people in that industry, vet the concept, and really get some feedback around, you know, the potential pathway to market. And they, at the end of the class, if you have some good proof points around that, and if the story kind of holds together and it looks like that industry or market is taking off, then it usually is a good launching point into some of these competitions like the MIT Clean Energy Prize. And we've had a number of teams over the years actually go on to win in those competitions and do quite well, and then actually, you know, start companies and raise money, get acquired, and have a pretty meaningful impact.
So what are some examples of some success stories that stand out to you?
There's a few going back that I think are pretty interesting. A great one is a team from 2008. It wasn't the actual project that was selected. So there was a student named Oliver Stahl who learned about demand response through the Internet case study that we did. This is, again, 2008 timeframe. And he said, this is great. I want to go and do this in Germany. And he started a company after graduating from MIT. So it wasn't through the class. But it was just great to see that student learn about a whole new market, say, I'm going to go do this in Germany. And then he actually got acquired. His company got acquired by Internet about 5 years later. So that was one, you know, kind of earlier example. There's a company called Air Labs, a great Wright woman, Alex Wright Gladstein, who came to MIT and was looking through the labs on behalf of the class and found a technology that brought essentially chip-to-chip optics or optical communications, and that increased the speed and efficiency of computing, and was able to get pretty complicated agreement in place with MIT, with Berkeley, with Boulder, and around this technology, and form this company that you know, can have a pretty meaningful impact on the efficiency and performance of computing. And you can imagine the potential energy implications on that front. And another interesting one was a Bright undergrad, Tisha Feldman Fitzhugh, a great modeling and mathematics capabilities, and Mike Reynolds, who was a previous life in Goldman, kind of met in the class, and they were just the perfect combination to start a company that used advanced modeling to improve the output estimates for power projects and essentially reduce the cost of capital for various types of energy projects. And their company was a clean sheet of paper in the course. There was no lab or tech that went into it. It was really just these two co-founders coming together, starting a company, and eventually getting acquired by Ultra Capital. And they're now the kind of core technology platform that helps Ultra Capital develop and finance small, mid-size energy projects. And so those are just a few. But it's been great to see the range of different technologies and ideas that have gone on to actually start businesses and, you know, scale up and raise money and have exits and ideally have an impact.
And is there a natural progression in terms of, as these companies go through the course, for the ones that are the most promising and have the most momentum and seem like they potentially have some legs to go and become a company, what is the next step coming out of that course from an MIT standpoint? What do you do with those people and those teams?
The course is in the fall only, and most of the competitions, especially the MIT Clean Energy Prize, are in the spring. So there's a natural progression from this class into those competitions, and a very direct one for MIT. Air Labs was a winner of one of the MIT Clean Energy Prize events. So that was a key point for that company. But, you know, there's a whole host of other resources through the Martin Trust Center. There's the Delta V program, which provides an additional stage. So if you think about the kind of academic calendar, they've actually done a great job of having their Delta V program, which is over the summer, uses that the Trust Center's resources to really get the kind of best of the best of these various student-based companies, not energy or climate focused, but it's a more broad program. But there are a number that have gone through that. They have a big event in the first week of school in the fall semester, and that's a great motivation for students to go out and find out what classes and resources are available. And so the way we structured this track in terms of energy is in the courses in the fall, the MIT Clean Energy Prize is in the spring for teams that want to go through Delta V. That's another pathway. So you have another kind of extension into the summer where you can get additional resources through mentorship. The physical space at the center can be used essentially as an incubator. And there's some funds for traveling to conferences or meeting with customers. And so there's a number of resources available for students through, you know, various programs at MIT. And one of the things that we do through the Energy Ventures course and then also through the MIT Clean Energy Prize is try and connect students with mentors. And there's a great alumni network through alums just of Energy Ventures. There's about 400 alums now who are primarily working in energy all over the world. And so students that are in that class have access to tap that network during the course, but also afterwards. Same thing with the MIT Clean Energy Prize. There's a tremendous network of thousands of students that have gone through that event. Most are not actually from MIT, but there's a great resource, the other students that have gone through the program, as well as the judges and the mentors that have been resources for those teams as they go through that process.
And I assume, I mean, with the Clean Energy Ventures, is it only open to MIT students, or can they have collaborators and team members that are not part of the university? And then same thing as it relates to the Clean Energy Prize.
MIT Energy Ventures is primarily MIT students. We do have some Harvard students. There's you're able to cross-register for certain classes. We have had students from other universities involved, not directly in getting credit for it, but involved in the teams. There have been teams out of Yale and other, I think, out of Tufts as well over the years. So it's definitely not just MIT, and I think that's important. I mean, there's a great, tremendous network within MIT, but there's also a very strong and broader network in the Boston area in energy as well. And we've definitely pulled from that in the class. I mean, the class is very project focused, but we've had two secretaries of energy speak in the class. We've had the former science and technology advisor for Obama speak in the class, John Holdren, who's also at Harvard. So we definitely pull in resources from the best organizations and kind of the best backgrounds as possible for the students in the class. As far as the MIT Clean Energy Prize, that is open to student teams from anywhere in the world, actually. That competition was primarily funded by the DOE for many years, and that funding had to go to U.S.-based teams, but there had been international teams through that competition as well.
And with the benefit of hindsight, do you find with all the success stories that you were rattling off, are there common criteria that are shared across that are good predictors of success, or is it all over the map?
Good question. I definitely want to spend more time getting some real data behind that. So I would say maybe check back in a little bit. But the best indicator for success, I would say, based on my just perspective, not doing a deep analysis, would be an individual or two who are highly dedicated and committed to pursuing that idea or technology. I think you need to have someone that's really, really committed. And then the rest of the team is important, but can evolve over time. A lot of times, maybe only a few students, one or two or three from a team, stay with the company as it actually goes forward. So that's probably the biggest thing, is someone that is really committed and dedicated to pursuing that opportunity. And one person and company that comes to mind is Ben Glass, who started Alteros. And Alteros is a company that does, when it was in the course, it was, the original idea was a airborne wind turbine. And that was originally going to compete with the onshore wind market. And that was very quickly determined as that's a tough sell. Onshore wind is already really low cost, and that's a tough path. So they focused in the class on offshore wind because you didn't need any foundations. And so you can imagine having an airborne wind turbine that's tied to a buoy is a much kind of more effective approach. The problem with that, it was you had to have such a massive scale as your launch point. It was a very hard initial market. So when they continued forward with the idea, they focused on remote power. You can imagine remote communities or areas where it's very hard to install something. Here you can drive up with a truck and, you know, with a couple tanks of helium, and you have yourself a 1,000-meter tower. And what ended up happening was someone said, hey, can you put, you know, cell signals or, you know, cell tower equipment on this on that system? And they said, sure. And so now they have this super tower, I think is what they call it, but it's a very high tower that is really a heliostat. So it's connected to the ground and can produce power and provide the cell signal. And in that case, it took many years to go through that transition, but it was, you know, Ben's commitment to this concept of a 1,000-plus-foot tower as a new resource, and they got funding from SoftBank, and they were actually one of the founding teams at Greentown Labs. So I know you're very familiar with Greentown Labs, great resource, very deep in terms of MIT connections, but two of the original four companies were actually out of the MIT Energy Ventures class. So OzComp was the other one. Pedro Santos was the founder there. And so they were both in the Energy Ventures course and went on to start companies, and they realized they needed a lot of space for their hardware heavy ideas and got together to get some shared workspace in Cambridge. I think it was just on the border with Somerville. Maybe it was already in Somerville, but before they moved to Boston and then now back to Somerville. But in the early days, that's what, got Greentown kicked off. And there's been a number of teams from the class that have kind of cycled through there over the years.
And what about, I asked you about success predictors, but I guess the other side of that is, are there common traps that people fall into? And I'm definitely not asking you to name any companies by name or anything like that. But if there were students on the first day when these projects were getting kicked off that were about to head down this path, what would you tell them to watch out for? What advice would you have for them?
It's a good question. I'd say one of the most challenging things for a student coming into this class is the scale and complexity of the energy market and the climate problem. And it's very hard to know which technology or idea to focus on. And even once you've picked an idea, what's the right path to take? What's the best launch point for that technology or idea? And one of the traps, and this is kind of a constant battle between, I have this proprietary patented technology, very defendable, maybe a little more pressworthy kind of technology compared to an idea that might just not be defendable. And it's a good idea, but not, it's, hey, we're going to go start a wind development business, or we're going to start an energy storage development company. It's just an idea. The challenge that a lot of the teams that pick the technology path is that in some cases you find that it's very hard to pivot. Oh, wow, this technology is really good for this market, but this market really isn't that big. And there's another technology or another solution that solves that same problem in a much easier, faster, better way. And that's really hard to see in the beginning. And it's hard to give students that broad perspective. We do give a landscape in the first couple of classes around here's the world, the ecosystem that you're diving into, but obviously it's at a pretty high level, and we are able to go deep into certain segments, but you just don't have enough time. You could spend multiple years just on those, trying to understand the energy and climate systems, and whole careers are spent doing that. So that's the challenge for a student, and they get tripped up in maybe getting too focused on a specific technology when they're not looking at what's the real problem that you're trying to solve and what are the different ways of solving that problem, and really thinking through that before just picking a technology that's trying to find a home or trying to find a market.
And just practically speaking, given that a lot of these projects, it sounds like, are existing technology that's been in the lab for years, how do you guys handle things like IP? And then a related question is, at what point does it make sense to incorporate, and then with all the different students involved in different ways, like how does that equity arrangement get worked out? I would imagine it might be pretty messy.
That can be messy in the best of times. So I think in the best of circumstances. So for the course, we're very clear in the beginning of the class that this is an educational experience. This is, no one is guaranteed any equity, and we leave the arrangements with, if there is a technology kind of owner before the class starts, that any kind of arrangement has to be negotiated essentially outside of the class or after the class, and it has no impact on the grading. It's something that is typically driven more by the competitions. So if you think of the Clean Energy Prize, they have to cut a check to an entity. They can't just give an individual $100,000 or whatever the prize is that year. So the driver for incorporation is typically the competitions, and there's a solid 3-4 months between the class and when the teams need to incorporate. So that's usually when you see the teams incorporate. And then for the competition, you do need to be clear what the relationship or licensing arrangement is with the lab if there's a lab involved. And that can be a difficult process because a lot of times you'll be in negotiation with the technology licensing office at MIT or other institutions. And if you win the competition before you finalize your agreement, then people tend to want to renegotiate because you all of a sudden create all of this press around that solution, and it can drive a lot more interest from the general market. And so you do need to be careful and try to get ahead of it. And
it's like a domain. Like you don't want to go request to buy a domain if the person on the other side knows that you really need it super bad for your high profile thing with lots of money.
Right. So it's but it, you know, it's a natural process for starting any company, and we just make sure that we are very clear before the class that it's an educational experience, and there's no guarantees of any team members, getting any equity moving forward.
Uh-huh. And then, I mean, taking a step back, what else is going on at MIT on the clean energy front that's notable and interesting outside of the Clean Energy Ventures class and the Clean Technology Prize?
Well, the MIT Energy Initiative.
The Clean Energy Prize, right?
MIT Clean Energy Prize, right.
Yep.
The MIT Energy Initiative has been one of the big drivers for the Institute in pushing a number of different initiatives and programs. But the MIT Energy Club was actually kind of first to market, so to speak. The students were a little bit ahead of the Institute in getting an organization together. And the MIT Energy Club is an amazing organization that has done a number of big events. They have their annual energy conference, which was just held last week, had to be a virtual event this year. So it was unfortunate that they had to do that. But, that has always been a great way of getting the students to directly engage with a whole range of companies, of organizations, individuals across the energy world to either sponsor the event, to come and speak at the event. And that's probably one of the kind of premier energy events in the Boston area, and is always a great one to attend. So that I'd say the MIT Energy Club is a big organization. They're actually very open to membership. So whether or not you're a student at MIT, you can join. They have a great newsletter that provides a range of events that are occurring in the Boston area around MIT that week, and highly recommend it for people who are not familiar with it. The MIT Energy Initiative is, I think, one of the kind of most consistent and well-funded research areas in energy over the last 10 years. They've rolled out a number of different programs, a number of different reports, the Future of Studies. Recently, they did the Future of Transportation study, which is a great kind of analysis around what's the world of transport going to look like in the 2050 timeframe. And they're pulling from researchers across MIT. It's a multi-year process to get one of those reports out, and they can have some pretty interesting insights and some controversial ones as well. I mean, it's something that I think is it's hard when you're trying to aggregate a range of perspectives, but it's definitely a good example of how to pull together some various scenarios for the future. And they've done future of grid, solar, nuclear power over the years, and that's probably one of the bigger kind of initiatives they've had. And one of the teams this year at Energy Ventures actually worked with a modeling technology that's been developed within the MIT Energy Initiative, which really helps model energy systems. And in this case, for the class, the team was using that technology to essentially reduce the soft costs for solar development. So if you think of the price of solar panels dropping drastically over the last 20 years or so, you still have a lot of soft costs associated with installing solar. In some cases, the cost of sales is higher than the cost of the panels if you're looking at residential or commercial solar. And this modeling system was able to help reduce those soft costs. So we're seeing work that's done within the Energy Initiative get turned into various companies and get out into the market as well.
And we probably should have started here, but what about you? What else do you have going on in the clean energy world outside of your pursuits at MIT?
I started XL Fleet about a little over 10 years ago, and we provide the electric powertrains for commercial fleet vehicles. We started with hybrid solutions, broadened to plug-in hybrid, and we'll eventually offer full electric systems. So we sell to governments, Fortune 500 companies, utilities, everything from smaller delivery vehicles, vans, pickup trucks, up to larger delivery trucks, school buses, ambulances. And that's a market that's really just starting to take off. I think we were probably 5 years early to that space. But right now, we've seen a tremendous increase in demand for electrified commercial fleet vehicle solutions.
Uh-huh. And then you're also involved on the nonprofit side as well, right?
That's right. I'm on the board of the Woods Hole Research Center, which is a global leading independent climate research center.
And Phil Duffy, as you know, was one of the guests on My Climate Journey.
I know.
The head of Woods Hole Research.
Yeah, I heard that. I listened to the episode. It's a great one. And it's probably one of the most motivating things for me. I originally got into energy because of climate back in 2001, 2002 timeframe. It was very clear that climate change was going to be the kind of challenge of my generation as I was graduating. And it looked like energy was really one of the major drivers behind it. And at that time, in 2001, 2 timeframe, we were talking about these potential for feedback loops that could happen. You know, if climate change really gets bad, you're going to start seeing massive emissions being released from permafrost in the Arctic. And unfortunately, you know, that's really starting to happen, and it's bad. And it's a really big motivator for everyone to try and, you know, just move more quickly. You know, the urgency is really, really high. And there's others that, you know, drying out of the Amazon. You know, right now, forest fires in the Amazon are not natural. They're man-made, basically. You know, someone cuts down the forest and waits a few months and then burns the trees. But if it continues to dry out, you know, you could have runaway fires, and that could be catastrophic globally. So it's been amazing to be on the board and get that direct access to some of the world-leading scientists focusing on the cutting-edge climate research.
And given the urgency of the problem, it's amazing what MIT is already doing in this area. So I'm curious, as you look forwards, do you have any time for dreaming in terms of what type of role you could see MIT playing in the future, or any initiatives that you wish or hope that the organization would pursue that it hasn't yet tackled?
We're starting to see some more activity in, you know, what might be considered geoengineering. You know, this is going to be something that we have to consider. That is a very loaded term. There's other ways of reducing emissions that also can be done through natural systems. So how do you more effectively manage land to reduce emissions? So I think we need to start really pushing on solutions that, you know, wind and solar, you know, are basically there. I mean, they're already there. Everything new is wind and solar, but it's not happening fast enough. We need a lot more renewable power generation, but we also need other ways of reducing emissions and taking emissions out of the atmosphere. And just a couple points on that. I mean, the global investment in clean energy infrastructure, if you look at Bloomberg New Energy Finance, you're looking at $300 to $350 billion per year, but that's actually been relatively static over the last 10 years. Now, we've been getting more solar and wind in the ground because the cost per megawatt's gone down, but we need to make that $350 million, you know, into a trillion or 2 trillion, and the capital is there. There's no shortage of capital if you have projects that are essentially financeable, that have a good return on investment, and then that return profile is getting pretty low considering, you know, 3, 4, 5%. Can now cut it in some of these markets because there's so much demand for that kind of steady return. And so how can we accelerate the investment in the things that we know work today? And then what are the big swings that we can take, you know, in other areas that aren't, you know, kind of the traditional energy markets that can potentially help us, you know, bend the curve I mentioned land use. I mean, just simply changing farming policy, which is probably one of the hardest things to do in reality. But at the end of the day, you know, that's a path we should be really aggressively pursuing, having some more science driving that policy and really pushing to make changes. I think it's the kind of action that's needed.
Awesome. And is there anything that I didn't ask you that I should have, or any parting words for listeners?
I think the follow-up maybe to that last question around, you know, what are the things we could be doing looking forward? I mean, you know, I've mentioned geoengineering, and people are looking at direct air capture for CO2. I know of a few people starting to look at ways of accelerating the natural decay of methane. And some of the smartest people I know are working on that. And that's an area where I would love, if anybody's listening and they want to dig into a new area, that's something that sounds a little out there, but there are ways of, and it's not methane direct air capture. I don't think that's necessarily the pathway, although if someone can figure that out, that's great. It's how do you accelerate the decay of methane that's already in the atmosphere? If you can do that, you can buy us some time. You know, ultimately, we have to solve the carbon problem, the CO2 that's in the atmosphere. We have to rapidly reduce our emissions, but and reduce what's, you know, the concentration. Essentially, we're already well beyond where we should be. But if someone can help essentially accelerate the decay of methane in the atmosphere, that would be a big win. So I think that's an area where I'd love to see, you know, learn more what's out there. I try and ask people about that, you know, whenever I can. So that's kind of a call to anyone listening. If that's something you're interested in, please reach out. I'd love to try and provide some resources or connect you to people that are working on that problem.
Awesome. Well, I really enjoyed this discussion, Todd, and I learned a ton about all the great things happening at MIT. So thank you so much for coming on as a guest and for all the work that you do. And thanks to the Energy Initiative for having me come on as a guest host as well.
Well, thank you very much. I really enjoyed being on the podcast, and thanks again.